If you look at all of the, what the courts are going to look at is they're going to look at a preponderance of the requirements. They're not going to, for the most part, they're not going to look at one single thing. They're going to look at, okay, if you've got a corporation, it requires an annual shareholders meeting. What if I miss it 1 year? Oh, you're probably okay. An annual board of directors meeting, it requires that you have a filing and the filing be current with the state. You ought to be paying your tax returns on time. You should have issued corporate stock. I saw one case here last night I was reading where there were so many things that they did wrong. Oh my gosh. And the corporate veil was pierced. But there were like 8 things that they looked at. It was inadequately capitalized, which means they didn't put enough in to pay the debts, and yet the owners were still taking draws. They failed to observe necessary formalities. They didn't have annual board of directors meetings or meetings at all. The bylaws required that they have a vice president, but no one was named to the position. No dividends were ever paid. The corporate officers didn't function as corporate officers. They never had meetings. And the accounting was so willy-nilly, you couldn't tell the difference between their accounting and the business accounting. If you're not going to recognize the entity exists, neither will the courts. But the courts are looking at not just one thing that, he didn't pay his tax return on time that year, you know, corporate veil's blown. They're not looking at that. They're looking at the overall, are you playing the game or are you not? There are a few things like not having bylaws for a corporation or not having an operating agreement for an LLC. Letting your corporation expire with the state for 3, 4, 5 years. I think that's pretty evident that you'll lose your corporate veil if you don't keep up some basic things. But simply not having the mortgage in the name, no, that's very, very common. In fact, most of the time when you're doing an investment property, most of the time you're going to have to get the loan in your name. If you're going to finance it, you have to get the loan in your name to get approval. The bank is not going to give a brand new LLC a credit history, you know, without any credit history. They're not going to give a loan until you've had 3 or 4 or 5 years, until you've had some really good transactions. It's like a high school kid comes out of school and has no credit history. They're not going to, you know, let you buy a BMW for $80,000. There's no history. Unless somebody's going to co-sign the loan, and that's exactly what you're doing, is you're signing personally, and you could list the LLC responsible, but the bank doesn't care about that. They're going after whoever co-signed the loan who does have a credit history. That's really, in essence, what you're doing. But no, it doesn't mess up your corporate veil. And then when you're moving assets into an LLC, let's say the property is in your name because you had to get financing, is this now going to mess up your due on sale clause? Okay, you remember the mortgage companies have a due on sale clause, meaning it's a little paragraph that says, if you ever transfer this property out of your name, we'd reserve the right to call the loan due. But no mortgage companies are doing that right now. With rates, I heard as low on a 15-year loan right now, going in the 1.99. Are you kidding? 2%, 3%. If you've got a 2.5% loan and the bank calls the loan due, they know that you're going to walk across the street and go to a different bank. So nobody's doing that, although they have the right. If, however, interest rates climb back up to 8, 9, 10, 12, 15, 18%, I think that the banks are going to be looking for that. But they don't just call the loan due. They always give you a grace period and say, hey, we notice you've transferred the property into an LLC. Want to either come talk to us, or you get 30 days to transfer back. At that point, go down and tell them, talk to the bank president, tell them exactly what you're doing. And should you have done that in the first place? Yes, but big banks, you know, the Chase, the Manhattan, the Bank of America's, the Wells Fargo's tend to be a little rule bound. We're always better dealing with a smaller bank. You might not get the best rates, but you can walk in, talk to the bank president, show him what you're doing, get to know him, establish a history with him. And then at that point, we've found a lot less resistance to transferring a residential property, investment property, into an LLC. The banks are getting it with commercial. That's been a 20-year process. They understand they want that now in an LLC or a corporation. They haven't quite come to the terms to that.